find yourself in the Beachview area of Pittsburgh, check out the official pizza of this show, Slice on Broadway, sharing an abnormal obsession with pizza we can relate to. Check them out at sliceonbroadway.com and tell them this show sent you. Hey guys, it is the Awesomecast episode 273. Wow, 273. I'm Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitter from the Mayhem Studios here in Pittsburgh, PA. Ready to talk tech geeky things from a Three Rivers state of mind. Yeah, that's the new line. I like that. With me in studio, it's an all in studio day. We got, of course, John Chichilla is joining us.
How's it going?
And I realize I was probably just John Chichilla for a moment there as well. We're doing that weird title thing today, so excuse me. It probably won't be correct, though. How you doing, Chilla?
Pretty good. How are you?
Good, good. And also with us, hey, this guy hasn't been on. Were you on, like, episode 3, and I have not asked you back since?
I had no idea that you had done 270 more episodes. I was wondering where the show went.
You thought this was going to be episode 4.
I'm a little insulted that I haven't been asked back.
Listen, and if there's anybody that I haven't asked back or haven't asked, it's merely because I just haven't thought of it when I had my Twitter DMs or email open. That's it. Yeah, I'm very absent-minded when it comes to that. John Carman is joining us. Carman Avenue.
In studio. I'm excited to be in studio, too, because I moved my desk, and I really didn't want to have to figure out how to do Skype again. It's audio problems.
And I feel bad because, like, when you were on before, we were kind of just figuring out some of the stuff with, like, the desktop presenter and people bringing people in over Skype. And I think we had a weird thing where you and Rob were on the same screen and I just captured that. And it was very awkward. And maybe that's why I was ashamed to have you back.
Don't say it like that.
Say, we've been off Skype for long time.
Yeah, a long time. But the sad part is I used Skype like 2 weeks ago and I was like, wow, this looks really good. Wow, maybe I should be using Skype again.
How many people were on the call though?
Oh, just two. Just me and the other person.
Yeah.
But I mean, that's...
Well, what do you use now? Google?
It's Google Hangout. Yeah, we use Google Hangout.
It doesn't matter. It's all audio because we have, you know, my boyfriend is a DJ and we have all that equipment that I don't know how to use. And if he's not home, forget it. I'm just switching knobs.
I think that was the that was the status when we had you on before. You're just like, there's stuff. I turned this thing. How is this? And we're like, sure.
There's an on switch. We're good to go.
But anyways, this, of course, is the Awesomecast. You can check it out at awesomecast.net. Subscribe to us on YouTube, iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, iHeartRadio, and a couple other places. I think we're on SoundCloud now. I just hit the button for that in the last week on most of the shows.
Like us on Twitter.
Like us on Twitter. Apparently, like us on Twitter now, as we've been talking about here before we got into the show. And check out everything. We're on Facebook, Twitter, kind of Google Plus. I mean, I'll get a notification. So if you're out there,
I don't know. You use Google Plus more than most people.
Really?
Yeah.
Does it look like that? Because
well, I think you're the only one I know who uses. You and maybe Chris Brogan still does. Okay.
Our Mike Elegan and Guy Kawasaki. I've been trying to repost my blogs to it because I figure that's stuff that's going to do well. Mm. But I'm like cross-posting my blog everywhere these days, you know. But I do one blog a week, so it's kind of easy for me to do that.
You only do one post a week?
I do one blog post a week, but it's also my newsletter. That's how I got myself back into writing.
Right.
And I turned the rest of the blog into a video cast.
Okay.
So I'm like, let's work with your strengths here. So, obviously.
You do a lot. That's why I was surprised.
I do a bit. But anyways, you guys can help this situation, this podcast situation as well. If you're digging Awesomecast in particular or the Awesome Chats this week, program note, we will be a little late with the Awesome Chat. We didn't get it in as usual. So we might have one Friday if the scheduling works out this week. So keep an ear out for that. We actually had our friend from Travel Wits on that we helped out before, and you can find out how we like apparently helped him with a bug fix when we talked about his website on the show back in like April. But that's over at awesomecast.net. But you can support this crazy endeavor at the patreon.com/awesomecast as our good friends that are supporting us, and they are on the executive producer level. So that means very soon they are going to be getting business cards from us, from Awesomecast, that say then they can hand those out at parties and networking events. Well, I'm an executive producer. If that's more exciting than your day job, I don't know. But it depends on the situation when you want to impress somebody. But thank you, Michael Fedor. I believe that's at Michael Fedor Show on Twitter off the top of my head. And Thistle C Business Development up in Cranberry, at Thistle C on the Twitter. Thank you for supporting the Awesome Cast. And please thank them for supporting the Awesome Cast out there in Twitter land. So let's get into it with the awesome things of the week. Guys, can I start off here with talking about some happy little trees?
Oh, go right ahead. Oh. What do you do?
Okay, so I think everybody for the most part has heard by now, there's a new Twitch creative channel going on. And actually, I just pulled it up. So this is, it's not, you know, Twitch, of course, is for game streaming. They kicked everybody else off. They killed off Justin TV, which was one of the things that we streamed on for a time being. So I was a little miffed at that.
But I paid for the app.
You paid for the app to try app. Doing that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the iPad app, because we were trying to figure out like how it was. So you had a feedback because mm-hmm. we didn't have the feedback in the studio yet, and you wanted to see what was going on. And so now they started a new one that's creative, and it's mostly that's you. It's mostly painters and people just doing art, and they're streaming them doing art. And this is really cool. Right now, Adobe is doing live streams right now.
I think this idea is brilliant because it's going to get people looking at the tools and saying, oh, I didn't know it could do that, so exactly. I'm going to go buy it.
Exactly.
Or it's going to, and I think if you can get in right now on kind of the ground floor of this concept, you're going to get more people involved in whatever you're creating, whether it's a podcast or art or whatever. I just look at this as a great venue and kind of startup concept for getting more people involved with and getting people, other people learning.
Adobe's been podcasting for years, though. This is just an extension of that.
Yeah. And they were really good about, like, hey, here's the tools. Here's how you use them. You know, I can't believe all the, like, hey, we've had a new version, and it bugs you. Like, here's all the new stuff. I'm like, I really just need to do the stuff I've always been doing. I'm not really a high-level Photoshop user these days like I used to be. It's pretty cool. But, of course, the biggest thing, and if you look through here, it's a little bit of they have art. They have people making crafts. We have people playing music. We have, as with any good stream on Twitch, there's a half-naked girl doing stuff. Something about knives, it looks like.
Ouch.
And there's a lot of really interesting stuff going on there. But the biggest thing that really captured everybody's imagination was one Bob Ross, as you may know from, you know, back in the 80s and 90s, the painter, the Happy Little Trees guy. It was at MTV or M2 that had the Happy Little Trees promo. But they've been playing, 200 hours, 400 hours of this stuff. It's still going. It started about a week ago, and it has just captured everybody's imagination. I had this on for an hour and a half before I went to bed Thursday night.
He's been on YouTube for a while.
Oh, yeah. But it's just, you know, between, like, it's on after he finishes a painting, everybody types GG for good game. they're just like, this... Somebody just said I'm too high for this, and it's like really freaking soothing.
And that's what I think it is. I think it's extremely soothing. Mm. It's like, I think someone else compared it to watching a cooking show.
People are writing XXX for some reason, or lots of X's. I don't know. That porn Bob, you know, they're just like taking stuff out of context and just being completely ridiculous with it. But I just like Chromecasted it to my TV and just like had it going. I have Riz from InsertCoinToBegin.com. He has been watching this the entire weekend, I think. And he just has been just dropping me Bob Ross lines the entire time on Google Hangout. And it's been kind of weird. And I'm kind of worried about him.
He hasn't slept in days.
He hasn't slept in days. He's just thinking about how he just, if it is, he's dreaming about happy little trees and puffy little crowds and the almighty mountain that just got drawn in the background. You know, I mean, it's fantastic, and I think it's a really, but with this, I've seen reports like what first article was 50,000 people are watching Bob Ross on Twitch right now. 64,000 people are watching Bob Ross on Twitch right now. And something else I was listening to was saying that's more people than probably watched him ever at the same time, his entire run on PBS.
That's very possible. I think we really had five channels back then.
Yeah, exactly. Right. But still, you know, how many people were that into Bob Ross on, I don't know, what, a Sunday afternoon? I don't even know when he was on. I didn't get Bob Ross.
Really?
Like, we didn't even have, we had three channels. We didn't even get the PBS. So this is all new to me. We were so out of it. I didn't get Sesame Street until my aunt in New York gave me VHSs, like a couple of VHSs of Mr. Rogers and Sesame Street.
You didn't get Mr. Rogers?
Nope. Really? I didn't get any of that stuff.
What was on your PBS?
I didn't have PBS.
How did you know that everybody has PBS?
I didn't get PBS. In Mercer County, we did not get PBS.
Wow.
We didn't get it out of Cleveland, Youngstown, or we didn't get Pittsburgh stuff either. It's just that's the way it was. And I had my three tapes of Sesame Street to Mr. Rogers, and that was my experience until I visited my grandparents down here, and they had PBS, and I got to watch that. But nope.
I would have never guessed.
I had no idea.
I mean, I've heard of people living in Detroit and getting, like, the Mr. Rogers and the Canadian version of Mr. Rogers, but ooh, I've never heard of people not getting Mr. Rogers.
That's the way it is, man.
Canadian version of Mr. Rogers.
It's like Mr. Blue Shoes
Mr.
or something.
Mr. Rogers
like
can't
that.
Be any nicer.
No, why do you think I'm so, like, heavy into everything now? Because I was so devoid of technology growing up. Mm. I didn't even have cable. We had satellite in 1996. Like, it was so bad. I got out of pro wrestling because it was on cable for several years. Yeah, and you know how into that I am. That's why it's just like, oh, I have access to everything. The internet's amazing. But anyways, that's a whole other conversation. So I don't know, and we had some ideas about, I think, did we do that before the show? I can't remember, about putting a camera up in the corner. Maybe we'll talk about the process or whatever it is that's going on here. We'll see. We'll see. I like to, you know, I'm not sure how far you can stretch the creative side of this. Oh, I almost forgot. Miss Sinbin, at Miss Sinbin on the Twitters, tweeted us this. There are people using MS Paint. Chachi, I hope you're listening. People using MS Paint to enjoy painting with Bob Ross streaming on Twitch. Welcome to the future.
And this is pretty impressive.
The future. What is...
actually, it's gone back about 20 years.
No, I get the retro joy of watching
okay,
Bob
that one's
Ross.
A rough.
but it's been on YouTube for a while, you know. I mean, why is this popular now all of a sudden? You could have used MS Paint to paint along with Bob Ross.
Well, I think this earlier is a culture thing, because Twitch is like a ridiculous, just its own culture. It's a younger culture.
I want to speak to that point, because every once in a while a new streaming service comes out that does pretty much exactly what the previous streaming service did, and everyone jumps on it.
Right.
And we've been jumping from streaming service to streaming service for years, and most, I mean, if they have any difference, it's a small improvement, a small feature that the previous didn't have,
right?
Or elimination of a feature that wasn't used.
Well, I also think it's interesting with Twitch, because they, you know, again, they were basically just in TV, and now they're opening things back up so you can do more things on Twitch. But they hyper focused on that community for gaming because they saw something there. And now we have this, and now we can, like, bring stuff back around like Bob Ross. And now it's a hit because, like, this community just grew. Like, I'm playing with Reddit right now, and I'm trying to get into that and trying not to get banned accidentally from some of these subreddits, and which has happened once. You know, it's a whole different mentality. And I was talking with somebody today about, you know, what you put on there and how do you promote your own thing on Reddit. And you can't be completely self-promotional on it, because that's against the guidelines. You're just promoting, and you have to be part of the community in order to say, hey guys, I did this thing over here, for not to be kicked out of stuff. Don't just go in with an if this then that script and just post all your stuff to it. That's bad news. I learned that. don't do that. Please let me back in, Squirrel Circle. But anyways, I didn't even know I was doing it. But like that kind of thing, like, there's that community there, and then you kick something like Chachi's amazing paper doll Hillary Clinton article that he put on InsertCoin to begin, which I'm like, okay, that's the mentality of this community. Boom. He had like 400 hits out, or 150 hits out of nowhere. I mean, it was 400. Or this is something else we did with the wrestling last week, you know, just like exploded on there too. Like, you know, that's what this is. It's kind of bringing stuff around and talking to that community a little bit better. So.
Well, maybe when you jump from service to service, it kind of eliminates the noise for a little while. It eliminates right. all the junk and garbage and the sifting that you have rebooting. To do. Yeah.
Yeah.
All that sifting that you have to do.
It's, everybody liked Google Plus because all the idiots weren't there.
Right.
Right.
And you didn't have to worry about what you posted because your parents weren't there. You didn't have to worry about offending this person because they weren't there.
Exactly.
And it was, it did seem to have that hyper focus of
tech. It was all the tech heads and like the doers.
Because mm-hmm. I was here in the studio, a few weeks ago, and we were using Periscope.
Right.
Is that done now? Are we done with
Periscope? No, apparently not. I was just on a podcast last week talking about Periscope. So,
well, there's a Periscope app for Apple TV.
And there's a Periscope for Apple TV. Yep.
Which I think is going to be, is going to make a big difference. I mean, it's going to get.
Let me ask you this. Has Bob Ross ever been on Periscope? Yet.
I don't think he's had the opportunity, but no, I don't think that's going to happen there. You know, he passed in like 1995.
You don't. Someone can make that happen. You just point your Periscope at your Twitch.
That's true, too. I don't know. I don't know if that community is there for it. I'm trying to figure out because I feel like there's a little bit of waning of the Periscope community. Like something seems different in my app. Or maybe it's just me because I'm not Periscoping enough anymore. But
I always felt like Periscope was, I'm bored, I'm going to see. It, to me, it was like the replacement for channel surfing.
It is, but I mean, again,
because you have to be a special kind of person.
These darn kids in their YouTube. And
that's, I guess you have to be a kid or a special kind of person that has nothing impeding them from jumping on Periscope willy-nilly when someone decides they're going to bump up their Periscope. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like not that that's not convenient for, I would say, the vast majority of professionals. Oh, so-and-so is Periscoping. I'm going to bring that up and watch it right now. You're in a meeting. You're driving in the car.
Well, I think there's also, are you a consumer or are you a watcher
right.
too? Like it's, I don't think a lot of people are both. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of people like, I'm a person that's going to broadcast. I'm very much, you mentioned right. Carmen before, I broadcast a lot of stuff. I don't sit down and watch a lot of Periscopes. I probably should so I can kind of figure out what works on there.
See, that was my thing was, is I found myself, I didn't really have anything that I wanted to Periscope,
mm-hmm.
but I wanted to be part of the community. So in the evenings, when instead of being bored with what's on TV,
you've made Periscope appointment time is what you have to do.
Like I would go out and I would look for live Periscopes. I would look at people's prior Periscopes.
And again,
like I would, that was my consumption.
For those out there, you know, we're not the typical case. We're trying to like, okay, how can we bend this thing to our will? And make mm-hmm. Periscope do a thing for me, you know, versus the other people are like, oh, it's just a fun thing I can do, you know, and which I can understand. Well, why would I Periscope? Like, we want a Periscope because people are watching.
Right.
And we want the people to watch the thing we're doing for whatever the reason is.
And I wanted something to watch, so that's why I would go on.
Exactly.
Oh, but, so you are the test case.
Yeah, but I, like I said, I was the...
Well, you're, and still, this is why you're still a tinkerer, though.
Yeah, but I'm excited for it to be on Apple TV because now instead of me grabbing a mobile device and sitting here and being like, I can. It's like, to me, it's like changing the channel.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And that, to me, that's very convenient.
I like that idea. Chilla, what's your awesome thing of the week?
My awesome thing of the week. Speaking of the new Apple TV shipping, I have, and we've talked about the Air Squirrels before. I got and we've talked about their reflector product. This is Air Parrot. So if you have a Chromebook, Windows device, Mac OS device, Air Parrot lets you take and stream your device to an Apple TV. You can actually stream to, I think, multiple devices. I think it does support Roku, it supports Chromecast, it supports a number of things. It also gets pretty granular with how you're presenting. So you can present a single app. You can present your entire screen. You can stream actually just the audio or just the video and not both. It'll help you break that apart. It's nice for if you're giving a presentation and want to show something. That's kind of how we've talked about Reflector. Or I think you've kind of moved on to the more wired connection.
With Duet.
With Duet and no, but for streaming your device.
Oh yeah, yeah. That was really killer when you helped me figure out that I could do it through QuickTime Apps.
Yeah,
that was amazing.
But the wireless aspect to me is nice. Air Parrot being cross platform, a license is only $15, and they do give a free trial as well, which is nice. I'm a huge fan of all of the Air Squirrels product line. And Air Parrot just adds to that. They have updated to work with the new Apple TV, like I said, as well as Chromecast, and they are cross OS support, which I really like. So that being said, go out and buy up, or at least give it a try, right?
Right.
See what you think of it. Give it a try if it's something you can use. I see a lot of people presenting that have to go around and give presentations all the time. And they might be going to this site that has an Apple TV. They might be going to this site that has Chromecast. This guarantees that you can pretty much broadcast to anything.
And so it starts at $14.99, and they have multi-license deals out of it as well. So, but Reflector was a really cool app with that kind of thing. And I still would kind of... I think I ended up using it... Did I use it? I think I ended up using it for a presentation at the library.
I still use it for recordings, because it'll record. It kind of gives you the look, that frame around it. That makes it look right. Like,
if you have a solid connection, I don't have that down here in the studio.
So that's what I kind of use it for. Still. Cool. And I like its recording capabilities.
Cool. Check it out at airsquirrels.com/airparrot. John Carman.
Yo.
What is your awesome thing of the week?
All right. Tell me if you heard about this. You probably have. The Best of the Burgosphere Blogging Awards.
I saw Yajagov talking about this.
Yajagov talked about it. Basically, the way it works is it's an awards for local Pittsburgh bloggers, but it's not competitive. Everyone gets an award, and the awards are made up by another blogger. So each award is catered to the recipient, and they're pretty funny. So each award gets a blog post about that blog. The name of the award is made up, and they're generally a pretty funny review of what that blog is all about. And at the end of the month, there are going to be two dates. There's a Friday, November 20th, Friday evening 21 plus event, and then a Sunday event the following Sunday during the day, family friendly version. I think the only thing not family friendly about the first event is the alcohol, but it's all kicking off this Friday, November 6th, during Unblurred at Most Wanted Fine Art, with a art of blogging display. And some of the bloggers are actually creating art, collage and photography and multimedia related to their blogs. There are other artists that are creating art about blogging. So that is all leading up to the award ceremony at the end of the month, which I will actually be a judge for and handing out some of these awards to the winners. Nice. But everyone's a winner.
And I see our friends at Bold Pittsburgh are a part of this as well.
That's one of the reasons I thought you would know about it. Bold Pittsburgh did the logo.
Awesome. So what's the go-to spot to find information on this? Mostwantedfineart.com looks like it has the event info.
The main page is at mostwantedfineart.com, and then the two of, all three events are on Facebook. So the first event, again, is this Friday, November 6th. It kicks off with Unblurred on Pen at Most Wanted Fine Art.
All right, go check it out. So, want to get to a couple of tips, apps, and some fan submissions here for the week. But first, let's touch base with our friends. Give a shout out to Slice on Broadway. They're providing some supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza. We have our in studio guests. You guys get to munch a little bit before or after the show, and it helps get through the long night of podcast recording that we have going on here.
I've heard really good things. I haven't actually had Slice on Broadway yet because I was late getting here. I will have one when we're done, but I've heard good things about that place.
Awesome. But go check them out. They got two locations down here in the South Hills, in Beachview, right along the tracks, as well as Main Street down in Carnegie, PA. Fresh ingredients, friendly people, great stuff. They love to experiment with their pizza. And you can see that as well over on the Slice on Broadway on the Instagram, on the Facebook, or let them know you heard about them on the Awesomecast, PGH_Slice on the Twitter. All right, let's get back into it. I thought that this was pretty funny. For an app of the week, have you heard of Google's Who's Down app? And I think it's Android only, so I didn't get the opportunity to really mess with it. And plus, the implications of this, I thought, were kind of interesting.
I thought it was an April Fool's joke, but the date was wrong.
Is it? Okay, okay. Because I kept reading this. I'm like, is this a joke? Is this a joke? But apparently, yeah, it's Google's new Who's Down app lets you know if friends are down to, or if friends want to, you know. And this is an article from the Next Web. Yeah, it's generally, I guess, the concept seems to be you open the app and say, hey, I'm down to do something. Like, hey, I want to hang out. Who's up for hanging out?
And I'm going to do that right now.
What, you're going to do that right now?
Yeah.
And I guess you can set levels of what you are down for, which down to hang out or coffee, movie, or you know. So it could just kind of turn into a hookup app. You know, they're saying that this is kind of a take on the Swarm app, and which, yeah, I can see that, you know, because they do have kind of like beacons or something in Swarm too, don't they? That do that?
I think they do, but I thought this, to me, the way I read this was it was like a thing against one of the, and I'm trying to find the app that the Microsoft Garage team released.
Mm-hmm.
There was almost the exact same kind of concept released by Microsoft over the summer. I think it might have been Toss Up or someone, but yeah, it was the same. I find this interesting because to me, it's the way people are heading with, hey, I'm going to go do this. Who else is in?
You know, and I've always had that too, because like I'll be like a Friday night, I'm like, man, I'd like to go hang out, but I feel weird just like going to Twitter and be like, hey, who's up for doing something? Because you're kind of worried, like, who might respond?
What
sometimes?
If no one responds?
No one responds.
What if no one responds?
I just feel sad because I'm just like, hey guys, what's up? You know, or going on Swarm and just hitting the Twitter button and saying, hey, I'm hanging out if anyone wants to swing by. You know what I mean? Yeah. When I'm at the coffee shop, you know, and that's, I mean, that's worked out sometimes, but I don't think there's a lot of people in the daytime just hanging out in South Hills. So I don't know if that works for everybody, but no, I think it's interesting and interesting that it's going to take this other way. I didn't put it in here, but I got a tip for the week too. Chilla, did you end up getting the Apple TV?
It's in my bag.
It's in your bag.
It's physically with us right now.
So
therefore it is not plugged in.
Have you seen the screensaver?
Which, the city ones? Which one?
The amazing screensavers that everybody's going nuts for.
The ones where it's like the pan overs.
Yes.
With night and day. Yes, I have seen those. And they actually, I think I put it in the show notes for last week. They actually released those for the Mac.
Well, they didn't release it.
Well, they didn't.
Yeah. They didn't release it.
On GitHub, there's
You can go to GitHub. If you haven't seen this yet, and I did see these first on This Week in Tech, they were showing them off. And they are pretty awesome. You can't really see it too well in there. Actually, I think this may have froze.
Okay. That looks frozen.
That looks frozen. Let's try it again. Uh-oh, it's not working too well. But when this works, it's not just an awesome picture. It's actually moving in slow motion. I don't know what's going on there.
There's one of Hawaii. I think there's San Francisco. There's, is that New York? Or is that the Golden Gate?
Golden Gate, I think.
And I didn't realize this. I actually first saw this, I think, on like 9to5 Mac or something like that. It didn't dawn on me till over the weekend listening to This Week in Tech, where they were kind of talking about it. And, you know, they did a bunch of flyovers and 3D flyovers for the different cities for maps. So this was probably a good way for them to just reuse raw footage of what they had recorded for those flyovers to then take and turn into a very tranquil, pretty screensaver for your TV, because no one wants TV burning.
Right. And here's so apparently, I think the screensaver is interfering with Desktop Presenter and Wirecast, because it was moving sleep until I switched to it, and then it stopped. And I noticed it just stopped because I have it on the iMac. I put it on every Mac I own because I just want to see more of it.
Put it everywhere.
I just put it everywhere. It's pretty.
If you have multiple monitors, you can put different ones on different monitors.
I just saw that setting. I just checked that setting on here. I don't know how many times. So it'll be like on this and on the iPad when I'm doing a duet display thing. Mm-hmm. It's going to be amazing. But anyways. It's great. And I guess you would say, they're streaming these images off of a server. Is how they're doing this?
I think it's video. It's not there. It's not a bunch of
video
images.
But they're mostly like streaming down from a server when you're doing this. Yes. So I guess the question is, how long do they let them do this? I feel like Apple's not gonna care in the long run.
I don't think they're gonna care in the long run. And I think someone already started to copy them elsewhere. Mm-hmm. So if Apple does start to have an issue, you're just going to see. I think you're going to see two things. You're going to see the copies of the files cropping up everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And B, if they even try to go after that, you're going to see a ton of people with drones doing drone flyover recordings.
Just doing their own Apple TV. So I'm doing an Apple TV screen server.
I think there was that one thing Rob brought up where it was like the map and there was drone tours.
Right. Well, you can see like where somebody's gone up there. I want to look at that map now because I bet there's a lot more spots.
Yeah.
Now it's more prevalent.
So, but I bet you, I mean, think about it. If you could get a screensaver that queued up a feed off of there,
mm-hmm.
that would be pretty awesome.
I was going through my Amazon wish list, just kind of pruning things on there, and I saw like a $50 like drone with a camera. I'm like, I just need to get into drones, man. Like, I just need to try it out. You know, get a cheap one, you know, see how it goes.
Not to go back to Walking Dead, I know, but
No spoilers!
Portions of this season were filmed with drones.
Really?
Yes.
That's awesome. That's a cheap way to get a flyover when you're on mm-hmm. a TV budget, I bet. Mm-hmm. So, okay, we had some submissions on Twitter throughout the week and probably some other places. First here, let's go to this. Our friend Matt Weller, the former Nero of The Awful Show, he has a new podcast. I really need to remember the name of it, so I plug that instead of his dead podcast that was completely awesome, which I think you can still listen to. But he put a tweet out. He actually hit me up on this. A good deal for someone looking to get their feet wet. The Martian Notifier smartwatch is up for $34, according to CNET. And he talking with him on Twitter, he thought that maybe you talked about this before on the show, Chilla.
Was this a one that we found was a cheap alternative to kind of getting you trying it out?
I think so.
It looks like a watch.
Yeah, and it looks like a watch.
It actually looks like a watch, but it just gets like notifications, I guess, along the bottom there. So you can pull up a larger picture.
You know where I think we did talk about this on the show, and Techberg covered it on Facebook.
Oh, we did.
I think it was where I originally found the original article.
Okay.
For this. And I think he might have one.
Awesome.
So, yeah. I mean, it's an interesting concept. I mean, just getting notifications, I think, goes back to, you know, the original Pebble.
Dual batteries.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, dual batteries, so your watch will still work.
Even when your
right.
notifications it does don't.
Last a week. You don't have to charge it every day, which is nice. But even if you didn't charge it in a week, your watch will still tell time.
You still have the watch part. That's good. That's good. But it's the, like I said, it's the Martian Notifier, if you want to go look it up. And they say it's $34. Is there anywhere in specific here? Meh.com. This is a thing, and it's a store,
I guess. meh.com.
Meh.com. There it is. Huh. Remember to secure your security camera. Is this like a Woot?
I'm wondering the same exact
maybe we
thing.
Missed it. Maybe yeah. We might have missed the deal. But
I like how they have a map of who's buying this crap at the bottom of Meh.
Is it actually say?
Yeah, it says crap. That is very Woot.
It actually says who is buying this crap. At the bottom there.
California, Texas.
No wow. one's buying the red? Or maybe they didn't offer the red.
Well, this is something else. This is a security camera of some sort.
Security camera.
And it's got $68 for two, and it comes with black and white.
Yeah, I guess you wouldn't want that in red.
No. Hey, look at my security camera. But I mean, yeah, it is a little bit of that you might want.
What is so, meh?
Just type
the meh story.
There's the whole story.
They have a story and a frequently asked questions.
Oh, no. I need to tag this later. All right. Also, Doug Durda, he's our resident Sling TV user. And apparently Sling got back to him on Twitter. It says, we're happy too because Chromecast support officially launched today. And I think it was today or yesterday. So yeah, Chromecast support for Sling. I think that's pretty big news.
I think it's huge because to me, this eliminates the concept of having to get extra Rokus, extra whatevers to put all around your house to then kind of have the child cable boxes sitting all over the place.
Mm-hmm.
So I think this is a great concept. I'm actually, from a TiVo perspective, looking at kind of like a TiVo stream to kind of do the same thing around our house because there's not an easy way to stream TiVo to multiple rooms.
I'm going to drop back for a second. We talked about the screensaver. I forgot to mention, if you want it, go to just search for GitHub. And the name is John Coates, John Coates for that. And it's actually GitHub.com. I want to say Grubhub.com. That's different. GitHub.com/John Coates/Ariel. So go check that out. And finally, there's a little bit of a cross-promotional sort of situation here, but I thought it was wild and wonderful and interesting, and I thought you guys would have a lot of fun with it. But our buddy Chachi, as I mentioned before, he reviewed on insertcointobegin.com Hillary Rodham Clinton presidential playset. So it's a book, and it's basically presidential and political. Oprah Winfrey's in this, by the way. Paper dolls, basically. So have fun with that.
Did he actually pick this up?
Yeah, he was sent a preview copy. This isn't even released yet.
Oh.
So, yeah, somebody sent him a preview copy of this thing, and it's actually, the book is going to be out November.
Because he's a politician.
Because he's a politician. Well, hey, the people don't know, Chachi got elected. I actually hit him up. I was like, you know, hey, I'm completely out of touch. Should I go vote today? Is there anything worthwhile? And he says, you should probably go vote so some jackass like me doesn't get voted in again. I was like, okay, that's a good point. But, you know, it's apparently, like, it was the year where, like, I think all of us were just writing him in because we were just very unhappy with, like, the mayoral situation. So I wrote him in, like, everything I could think of. And somehow he got elected the part of the electoral board, like the person that goes on election day and basically oversees the voting machines.
Wait, so we somehow elected Chachi into the electoral college?
He got elected for two positions.
I think Krauss does that. Krauss got elected that in his...
Are you
his
using area. The word elected correctly? Not yes. Nominated?
No, he no, got no, elected. No,
elected. Like, it was his job. He did it for, like, two cycles.
He got nominated and then elected.
And then all of the...
We're not entirely sure for what.
We nominated
Not mayor.
Him. No, not mayor. No. It was for... Because apparently nobody votes for it because it's just a whatever. It's the person that oversees the voting machines, right?
Right.
And they get he gets paid, like, I think it was, like, $75 or something for the day. He has to call off work and do this thing instead, right? It just, like, doesn't work out, right? And apparently all the old ladies were mad because he got elected and their friend wasn't there anymore. And it was like, well, you didn't vote for them, so...
Right.
You know?
and this is why you need to get out and vote.
And this is why you need to get out and vote. So Chachi isn't running your local something. You know what I mean?
That's crazy. How did I not know that? How did we all not know that? I mean...
Oh, he was all about it. This is a few years ago. But yeah, it was a good time. So that's why he qualifies and get it. It's going to be on corkbooks.com, November 17th. If you want to check that out. And that is all that's, you were good. My notes were, I kind of jumped around in my notes, so I couldn't figure out what I didn't get. So with that, and you know, of course we're the absolute professionals over here. And we're completely doing our work to be even more professional. If you like what we're doing with podcasts, if you like, you know, I do video production. We do all kinds of fun stuff. And you can go to sidekickmediaservices.com and actually get a little bit of demo reel of a variety of things that we've worked on here over the years with Sorgatron Media Incorporated and then some. We're actually providing services video, audio, social media, website services for anybody in that need. So please go check out what we've been doing, and we'll have a new site coming up soon at sidekickmediaservices.com. In the meantime, go ahead and follow us on Facebook, on the Instagrams, on Twitter, on the Facebook, and let us know if you need any help with your project, and we'll hear from you soon. So with that, let's go check out what we did this past week in Sorgatron Media. And we'll be right back.
Made a lot of noises, but no language. He liked to bash his head off of things. Bricks, mainly. He would throw bricks up in the air and then jump and smash the brick. He was an interesting fella, Rambo was.
Oh, Chachi is not here, by the way.
Senor Maple Leaf.
Yes, he
is. It's Halloween. I'm allowed to do this.
Happy Halloween.
I am allowed to do this. I'm sorry. It's really hot under there.
If you've noticed, we have the travelwits.com, which solves the cheapest way to get from A to B, vacations within budget. And one of the problems that seems interesting to us down the road is utilization of hotel points and mile frequent flyer miles.
The Google Trends Fright Guys? Whoa!
So this will tell you what the trending search Halloween costumes search trends are. there, if you look at the top above the map, there's a trending nationally.
Zima says it all the time. Be humble. Just be humble, listen. And Zima's one of those guys where I feel like I probably wouldn't be where I am in wrestling if it wasn't for things he said and advice he gave me.
I like to think that Brock Lesnar and Undertaker just have baby fingernails that are like right razor sharp. And they just couldn't help it, you know?
And we're back. Like I said, check everything out. Sawtooth Willie gets horny this week over SorgatronMedia.com. I'll just leave you with that. And
I know
you'll
what that means.
He knows what that means. He knows what that means. Oh, your appearance is coming up soon, too, on Sawtooth Willie. Well, your audio appearance, I guess.
No, you see a chin, I think.
You see a chin or an arm or something like that? I didn't do you a complete Daily Show style, but...
No, you took that photo. Maybe it is audio only. Am I only a voice?
I don't know if you're on screen. I edited it like 2 months ago. So you'll hear that, the dulcet tones of one John Carman, very soon on Sawtooth Willie. Go look it up on YouTube and on the Facebook so you don't miss a video. All right. So, there's a little bit of I don't know what to call it this week. Android and Chrome OS, a story came out that apparently they're going to become one. One unified operating system to rule all the Googles. But apparently Google said, no, maybe not so much.
What happens if Google just gave up?
On what?
On both.
On both? Why would they?
But just leave them open source. Because I have a feeling... True. So, I'm going somewhere with this, right? I'm planting the seed for the concept. So to build off what you were saying, yes, there was a comment made last week that by 2017, Android and Chrome would be one.
The Wall Street Journal said this?
Super kids team up and they would, I don't know, Wonder Twins activate and we would have Crandroid.
So would the laptop or would the phone become the pail of water? Are we getting too old with that one?
What's interesting is people then all of a sudden started hypothesizing with what the future would look like. And I kind of asked this question when we saw the Pixel C this year at their fall announcement, which is their new tablet that replaces the original Pixel running Chrome, which is now the Pixel C running Android. And it has the cool click and place keyboard / touchscreen laptop-esque type thing. The question that I ask is what interface is going to win out? And I think for emerging markets, I think your Android interface is what's going to lead the way, which kind of goes against Google's, I think, primary way of thinking with everything's up on the cloud and kind of streams down as you need it. We all know in emerging markets with slow bandwidth, that's probably not the best way to always do things. Where I think... And where I was starting off, and I'm more than open to people telling me that I'm wrong. But what I think you'll see is sooner or later, they're going to just open source and let everyone run with Chrome however they want to run with Chrome, almost like they do with the Android open source project. And then you'll have their additional layers that go on top, which is the Google managed services that sit on top of Android open source and Chrome being open source as well. So that's my theory. AJ, you can tell me I'm wrong. And a year from now, you can tell me how I was wrong.
Well, hey, that's the thing. But I think more than that, it's not just the interface, but the ideology. Because Chromebook was awesome because remember the commercial when we were looking at it was like, hey, you got your Chromebook and you're doing things on the Chromebook and you threw it in a lake. That's okay. Just go get another Chromebook. All your stuff's safe because it's in the cloud.
And I don't feel like Chrome works well on a touch interface.
No, because it's not. I think you running to the Windows 8/ Windows 10 problem is who are we working this for? And you still need a second version. Now, it's not too much of a crossover because they're both running Linux, of course. And basically, what would you do? Just kind of put Chrome in an interface on Android. But again, this has kind of been discounted too. Like Google has kind of said, no, that's not really what's going to happen, right?
Well, I think what happened over the, so they made this, they kind of hinted at this announcement, and then over the weekend, I think people started going crazy. Like Dell just announced a new Chromebook that they're releasing. Obviously, they don't want Google saying, well, Chrome's going away.
Right, right. Because that would kill you for 2 years.
You have all these schools that are now working on switching from an iPad to a Chromebook. You have other places
schools that are suing over how screwed up they got because they bought iPads and went with a certain service provider. Uh-huh. And they sued. I think they sued both Apple and the service provider.
Well, it sounded like there was some stuff in some cases there was school officials that were in cahoots with certain providers.
Right, exactly.
It wasn't the way to handle that. And unfortunately, I think Apple got a black mark for that one. But Chrome lends itself. So let's go back to the models. Apple is a one-to-one, right? The iPad and iPhone aren't necessarily meant to be shared. They weren't designed to be shared by people.
No, absolutely not.
The Chromebook kind of follows, to me, the mentality of a Windows-type device, a Windows laptop, that where it's meant to be passed around by multiple people. That was built into the foundation. Going into Android, to me, Android just recently started offering multi-user interface to their operating system, which I think is helping lead that way to be able to go from Chrome to Android and be able to share that device. So I could see Android taking kind of a front runner spot and Chromebooks being the go ahead Dell, go ahead HP, go ahead whomever you want. Whoever wants to create a Chromebook, go ahead and create one. Throw the logo on it, you're licensed, and have a nice day.
We'll see. This is all purely speculation, but an interesting thought. Another one that is, I think this is a little more solid, but apparently Windows 10 upgrades are going to be, upgrade is going to be pushing changes. One for IT pros and bootleggers, as well as just generally planning to automatically offer Windows 10. I heard this is the point where it's going to, the explanation I heard was in a few months, you're just going to have Windows 10 downloaded to your computer as an update. If you have automatic updates on.
Yeah, it's annoying.
When they came up with a license, and the writing was on the wall months ago, right?
Oh yeah, with the automatic updates and everything?
Not just because of automatic updates, but they said that Enterprise was going to have to buy a specific branch license that entitled them to not have to upgrade and to be able to run
to stay on Windows 7.
Well, not just stay on Windows 7, but even in the Windows 10 world,
mm-hmm.
that they would be able to avoid Windows 10 automatic upgrades.
Because that's havoc if you're in IT, because you have things that, like, I'm not updating this computer. It's on Windows 8.1. And I don't want to update and find out that Wirecast doesn't work anymore. I'm not going to pay for the enterprise version or whatever to make sure it doesn't update to get the right to not update my computer. It's a very interesting situation we're finding ourselves in. Now for mom, grandma, you know, that dad, whatever, you know, I think this is a good thing in general.
So I think your shops that are running, if your shops are running literally out to Microsoft to get Windows updates, I could see this happening.
Mm-hmm.
If your shop has an on-premise Windows software update server that's caching those updates.
And you're saying there's like a central server in the building. Like you're saying bigger companies. And then they just kind of like overnight.
You actually have to go in there and approve. The company actually has to go in and approve updates because they do the testing to make sure that Wirecast doesn't break across the enterprise.
Right. Right.
So those types of shops, I think, are going to still be able to avoid this. I think anyone who's on a home license, a non-pro license, is going to get forced to upgrade.
And I think mostly for everybody at home, I don't think this is such a big deal. Now, okay, not entirely such a big deal. I did update that the security computer that I have,
mm-hmm.
that I set up the webcam and Sighthound on and everything. It's an AMD 64, Athlon 64, like the first one.
Okay.
With, I don't know, 2 or 4 gigs of RAM, it's not very happy with my decision to upgrade. It's not terribly happy about that. But they are also, the whole rumor thing from before, that you bootleggers, hey, you're going to get updated. might be kind of nice. Now, is this something like I have an upgrade disk for Windows 7? I've had a thing where I can't put Windows XP on a machine to upgrade from it to make this work legitimately. Because just whatever happens, like the disk is wrong, it doesn't like it, there's software that makes a blue, or there's hardware in there that's making a blue screen, whatever the case may be. If I just throw that in and it keeps giving me genuine advantage pop-ups, eventually, if I have it run all the updates, will it just push me to Windows 10?
I'm guessing, but then you'll get the non-genuine prompt again.
When I get to Windows 10?
Yeah.
But I thought it's going to kind of move us,
I don't think
quote, bootleggers up to it.
I think it's going to move you up to it, but I don't think it's going to make you genuine.
Mm. So you'll have a red letter, or a scarlet letter, on your Windows 10. Welcome to Windows Scarlet Letter. We're going to let you use all the features, but we're going to make you feel really bad about it.
Well, that's where I've seen, like, in the past, too, not necessarily XP. XP did, to me, a really poor job of saying you're not genuine.
This laptop, it continues to tell me I'm not genuine, and I don't know what I'm missing out of it.
Keep on keeping on, and they keep just on. Let me do it.
It doesn't turn anything off, so.
And that's where I think, starting in Vista,
yeah,
I think they started shutting stuff off.
XP was supposed to. I think, early versions of it did. But, and also, I mean, I'm installing XP Media Center, which was an OEM copy that's only supposed to go to one computer, and I'm putting it on every machine and it's fine.
It's because I don't think XP phoned home.
Right, so Windows 10. It did. I think it did. I think at a certain point, because you do the genuine, check, and it would say, oh no, you can't use this. It's already been used X times or something. But I think at a certain point when they've deprecated something like that,
Servers probably shut off.
Yeah, the server's we don't care anymore. But it still wants me to check in and do the advantage thing. So it's just a pop-up I X out, you know. Also, everything, I gotta make sure to check the box so they don't let me know every month that there's no more updates coming for XP. Except I'm getting a lot of security updates, to be honest. I still get a security update once every month or two.
Is it Defender?
I don't know. I don't check into it. Will say there's an update. I'll just shut some of these down. I have an update running.
It's that malware you have. Download new chunks of malware.
There you go. Okay, this was an interesting one because I like robots.
Robots.
And this is one of the Skype co-founders built a delivery bot that rides on sidewalks. Look at that thing. It looks like a six-wheeled trash can.
Until that guy with the cane knocks
Look
it
out,
over.
Guy with the cane.
Yeah, is this a face-off?
That looks amazing. So apparently this was, and they're mentioning in this article for the gadget, Amazon, Google, we're talking about airborne drones. Walmart is even getting into the drone biz, apparently. This one is going to be, the aim is to deliver, quote, two grocery bags worth of goods weighing up to 20 pounds in 5 to 30 minute deliveries. Starship, the company's name is Starship, and they have a non-flying robot, so okay. But they
were
said,
they originally airplane?
It could be. Could be. It's interesting, and it's another take on this, and maybe we'll just litter our sidewalks. This isn't happening. I guess I would see more of this happening in Pittsburgh than the drones.
Well,
would you think?
You shouldn't let them in Philadelphia after what they did to Hitchbot.
That's right. They did take out Hitchbot.
See, I almost feel like this is more meant to be at the back end of the warehouse at the loading dock.
Right.
Unloading the stuff and then shelving
it. That's nothing new. I mean, there's when I was doing the steel industry stuff, they would have these platforms that move unoperated, and there's these magnetic tracks, and they're just kind of moving stock and rebar and whatever the product is around, and I don't know. That seems, of course, they're trying to solve I want it to stick to a sidewalk. It's kind of the Google car of sidewalk delivery.
Well, what's going to happen? You're not going to get your delivery and they're going to say, well, someone knocked the robot over or it ran into a stone.
At least they don't have to worry about shooting it down. They have to worry about just running it over with a car and cracking it open like an egg and taking the contents out. Merry Christmas. I don't know. Robots.
How heavy is that thing?
I don't know.
Can
it looks
just
like
run
it could
away
be heavy.
With it?
It looks like it could be heavy. It can't be that heavy because then you'd have to worry about
John Carmen's going to have a collection of them upside down. Right. So they can't
just spinning their wheels. Yeah.
This house is going to be full of them. Oh, he's going to turn them into a conveyor belt system.
Oh, there you go. Wheels
are the robots.
There you go. There you go. Chilla, how's the Goog? This is going to be the new segment on the show. The Goog's got your back, man, after last week. Chilla, how does the Goog have our back this week?
So Google announced, or the Goog, as we're going to call them, our buds over at the Goog, inbox by Gmail is getting an update. And it's not just to include YouTube thumbnails, better voice search, and some kind of picture editing that some may refer to as nightmarish. I don't know what that necessarily meant, but it's an AI-powered response.
Okay.
To emails. So if you were to email me.
I'm scared.
Exactly. The Goog's on your back. Don't worry.
Oh, okay. So they got a little gift thing happening here. So this looks like the, the email comes up and says, I'm looking forward to it. So this is kind of like the quick replies on iOS, right?
Yes.
So they're not answering the email for you. They're giving you options.
So what it does is it reads and parses the email
right
via its service and tries to figure out what the potential responses could be to then let you kind of tap a button to generate the response. And what killed me is this was complete, to me, clickbait anywhere and everywhere today, because everyone talked about inbox using AI powered smart reply to respond to the messages for you.
Yeah, it's wrong. That's not.
Yeah.
That's
not this is actually pretty much, it's going to hand off the email, parse the contents, and then give you options to auto respond. It's not going to automatically respond for you. It's just going to give you some pre-built responses to smart reply with.
Until the robots become self-aware and yes. Google says we're all down to whatever.
Yes. Okay. Because there is nothing. I mean, I would think what John is saying is definitely the next step to this is, okay, you've become comfortable with the options at the bottom. Now check this check mark and let us respond for you all the time. Yeah.
This is going to get awkward. I mean, there has to be something that says this was an auto response, you know, or you like something like it's tiny at the beginning. You think?
In the future, if you check a checkbox that says I am okay with Google responding on my behalf.
What?
No one would ever do that seriously, though. I mean, we would all do that as a joke.
I would build four mailboxes and have them converse with each other.
Right.
Oh, no.
Just to see what happens.
Oh, no.
Start one, generate four mailboxes. Have one mail the other one, fill the contact address book with each other's addresses and see what Google does with it. Come back like 3 weeks later and the whole thing is just a constant conversation with itself.
All right,
it's going to be an orgy is what it's going to be.
Speaking of, well, that just killed my segue. speaking of automatic, autonomous things running our lives. I want to keep it local on this one. So this is from AlleghenyFront.org, site that I just learned about with this article. Pittsburgh's smart traffic lights are taking a bite out of vehicle pollution. Apparently they are working on, I think they already have it running in the East End. So basically these things, they set up a system where, they are looking at the traffic, looking at how many people are lined up, and they're actually reacting to it and changing the flow with the light systems. I think they're also tackling the North Shore next because of all the ball games over there, and that becomes a horrible gridlock. Like I was coming through the other day after Steelers game, and I was like, oh, the stadium's empty, the game must have ended a while ago. And then right behind us, the next person come through Squirrel Hill Tunnel said, yeah, we got backed up. And like we just missed it. I was like, so everybody was out of stands and just sitting in traffic at that point. Like that's how bad it gets on the north side. So
I think you can only fix that so much.
Right. Like that mass of it.
Have you ever seen a traffic cop and how bad sometimes they mess up the flow of traffic just by not letting the things being automatic?
You ever seen a traffic cop have a complete meltdown in the middle of an intersection? That's
gridlock for days.
That's gridlock for days and potentially a lawsuit sometimes. But yeah,
So I'm interested to see how well this works. And if it does work, more power to them. They should put it everywhere. I think what's truly going to cure the traffic problem is flying cars.
Bicycles.
Or bicycles and autonomous vehicles. To me, that's the only way. Take the humans out of the equation.
There you go. Why not? You know,
do you remember when we were kids and we would ride our bikes on the sidewalk?
I didn't have sidewalks when I grew up.
Remember,
I didn't have anything when
I didn't have PBS.
No, this is just roads.
This is just between me and Chilla now. You didn't have any
sticks with the round pieces of wood that he just kind of beat.
No, Mr. Rogers. No Canadian Mr. Rogers.
No, not even the Canadian one. We weren't even good enough for the Canadian bits.
Did you have Legos?
Yeah, I had Legos. Okay.
What's a Lego?
I have Legos. We had Duplos. Hey,
you know, I never had Duplos. Those are the baby ones, right? I just went straight to Legos.
That's what.
Big man Duplos with the Duplos.
After kids our age choked on the Legos.
Right.
Come out with Duplos.
My Legos, but I had so many Legos with teeth marks in it from my dog, not from me. Or maybe I don't know.
Hey man, my Duplo game was on point at that age. What was the point of this conversation?
Taking the humans.
I was just saying. I remember when we rode our bikes on the sidewalk, and now the sidewalks are filled with robots, and we had to ride in the street.
Skateboarding wasn't a crime when I was a kid.
We skateboarded the street and rode our bikes on the sidewalks.
I do see a lot more bikes downtown now, though.
Not just
by the rental by the hour ones.
Mm-hmm. All right. On that note, there's so many stories, so much good stuff. We should just turn this into a 2-hour show at some point, or
one day,
twice a week.
Twice a week.
I had the thing running through my head, like, maybe we should do a Thursday show. No, that's not. maybe that'll be a Patreon level at a certain
yeah
point.
That makes sense,
like be like twice weekly if we get to X point, right?
As long as the Patreon participant also helps out with the Thursday night show.
Well, there's one I was watching, Daily Tech News Show, like you're already 5 days a week, right? And they said if they get to X amount, they're going to actually have somebody in Australia do a Saturday episode. That's awesome. But that they got, awesome. I mean, they got a way bigger community than we do, of course. And they got a little more pull with the, you know, some people that have been at this game a little longer on bigger levels. So, but anyways, it has been a blast. John Carman.
Yeah, what? Oh, I didn't know.
Carman Avenue on the
Twitter. Carman Avenue on the Twitter. I'm pulling the thing up so I made sure I didn't mess it up. Long time podcaster as well. Well, ex-podcaster, I guess, right?
Long time ex-podcaster.
Long time ex-podcaster. Yeah. With the former Jeed Spod, of course. Is that still out there? Can people still listen to that?
No, I don't think so. Well,
is it part of the Internet Library?
No, actually, there probably are files on many. Do you remember how many podcasting directories there were at one time?
Mm-hmm.
You know, back in the day, we used to put links to each of them and links to each of the pod feeders. And
when I was a kid, we didn't have pod feeders.
That's true. That's true for all of us. Sorry, doesn't have to feel bad about that.
By the way, there's a comment in the chat from Missy saying, is this the get off my lawn episode? It kind of turned into that a little bit, didn't it? And I'm sorry. She said she responds on behalf of her bosses frequently. Her signature comes up, Missy Sorg, on behalf of. So maybe Google Inbox on behalf of. George the Robot on behalf of. But anyways, check them out, Carman Avenue. Your website... What's your website?
It is not snap, snap, snap.
Snap, snap, snap.
No, just go to Carman Avenue and at Twitter.
At Twitter.
Yeah.
And it's everything you need to know.
I promote everything through there just because I have the most followers since I started that so long ago.
We never even got to the likes, not favorites.
We kind of did in our own way.
Yeah.
We just like, that's all that it deserves.
That's kind of news,
really.
Though.
It got an at mention.
We should mention that. Try to favorite our tweets.
No, don't worry. Everybody's noticed by now, and people are not happy. I asked what's your awesome thing of the week. They said nothing to do with hearts. Was a couple of them out there. So, and it's something about gongs. I didn't understand the gongs part. So, all things noisy. I didn't get that.
My original awesome thing of the week was going to be Darth Jar Jar.
I saw that. I don't know where I saw it, but I saw it somewhere. I saw it on Facebook somewhere.
That's less techie, though. It's probably more appropriate for some of your other shows.
Oh my. But anyways, and of course, John Chichilla at Chilla on the Twitters as well.
John Chichilla on Facebooks.
Doing
and
things.
If anyone gets the Samsung 18-inch tablet, let me know because I want to hear about it.
Why did you have a new Apple TV in your bag?
Because I got it delivered, because it came in the mail.
Oh, so it's like in the box still, like in the box, bag.
Though. Yeah.
Can you show us the box? Can we see the box?
It's just a...
What's in the box?
It's typical.
What's in the box?
It's typical Apple packaging.
Oh, of course. You mean impossible?
Beautiful. No, it's just...
It's beautiful.
It's
Ooh, oh, did you get the new Spinal Tap album?
It's just a black bobble.
It's a black...
That's it.
I mean, it's still in the shrink wrap. I haven't taken that.
Did you get the big one?
No, I got the little one.
Okay.
32
Let me know how that goes.
But, I mean, you can kind of see if I tilt it in the light
just
right. Again,
can when you schedule a play date so I can come over and play with your Apple TV and your virtual reality?
Because then I have the I have the Stratus Nimbus.
Mm-hmm.
Not the Nimbus 3000, but the Stratus controller. The MFI controller that you can use with your iPad, so I can use it with this too.
Dude, we're gonna have a Cross Your Roads tournament, and it's gonna be epic. Anyways, go check out everythingawesomecast.net. Subscribe to us on the YouTubes, on anything. We put out a lot of clips of some of the stuff we do throughout the week on Daily Motion and YouTube, and on Facebook. If you see those, if you dig some stories, or if you heard it on the main show, please share those out. Help get the word out. You know, you don't have to give to the Patreon necessarily. Just help spread the audience, spread the awesomeness, so we can help grow
on Reddit,
a little
put
bit.
A link out there.
If you're on Reddit, apparently putting stuff on Reddit is a really good thing to do. So if you're on the Reddit and you like to, if you like what we're doing, please put us on the Reddit with a like the plugin I use to put links to the Reddit links says make sure you, I think it says on Reddit, make sure you have a witty title to your posts. Like, that's a suggestion on Reddit. So I think that's very interesting. I'm still kind of new to this. I'm about 2 weeks.
Do you favor
it
on Reddit
this.
Or do you like or do you
I thought
who knows?
It's the
or do you plus one?
It's the up arrow. I upvote it and I never downvote it. I don't want to be that asshole, you know? But anyways.
So it's like Yik Yak.
It's like Yik Yak. Which I hear is still doing very well. From what I understand. But anyways, go check out all that stuff out. Subscribe to us. Share things. And please check out patreon.com/awesomecast. And also big thanks to our community coordinator, Missy Sorg, doing the notes and the tweets all night long. Big shout outs. Does This Hold Up is going to be at PodFest DC on November 6th. Go hit them up and find out where you can get tickets. DCPodFest.com. I think for the rest of this week, 20% off everything we sell for orders of $30 or more at shop.spreadshirt.com/sorgatronmedia. You can get the It's a Podcast Night in Pittsburgh t-shirt and some other fun stuff we've been putting on there lately. Shouts to Kim Lyons over at nextpittsburgh.com. Has a great article up from our friends Looking for Group that we talked to on Awesome Chat recently. And I think that's everything I'm going to squeeze into the show. Thank you, our awesome chat room going all night here. You've been our awesome audience. Get off my lawn. Have an awesome week. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com.